Hi, my name's Ant Surrage. I'm a technical development manager at Fargro, and today I'm going to be talking about thrips control with biopesticides. So we'll go over some of the general challenges with biopesticides, and how some of those challenges become even more difficult when specifically looking at targeting thrips. We'll look specifically on a bit more detail around entomopathogenic fungi, how they work, what they do, and what to keep in mind to make sure you're getting successful applications. I'll expand a bit on what Jack mentioned earlier, with regards to growing degree hours and growing degree days and how you can use those tools to improve your crop protection program. And then finally, we'll do a brief overview of the products on the GB market, so the biopesticides, and then also touch on some of the chemical controls and also the physically acting products. So when we're looking at the challenges presented by biopesticides, I tend to like to think of them as falling into three categories. So efficacy. The efficacy of a biopesticide does tend to be lower than that of a conventional chemical. So where previously you might be expecting a kind of 90-95% level of efficacy, it's more likely with a biopesticide that it'll be about 60-70%. And that 60-70% is okay if it's predictably at that level. Because if you can have that level predictably, then you can build on that efficacy with the application of things like macrobiological controls or improved cultural and mechanical levels of control. But how do you get that predictability? You need to ensure that the products are being applied at the right time in the correct way. And that all leads to the system being more complex. So there's a lot of need for specialist application, specialist understanding of pests and diseases, knowledge of how the product works. So it all becomes quite a knowledge intensive system, which is why it's really important at this time of year to be thinking about how you can integrate these products into your program later in the season so that you don't have to worry about all that complexity when you start finding the issues. So each pest and disease tends to present its own challenges, and thrips present some particularly difficult challenges. They're cryptic, small, and fast through their life cycle, so it is often difficult to get control of them. But some key areas to think about will be understanding the pest's life cycle and biology. So where is the pest likely to be? Is it going to be in the soil at that life cycle stage, or is it going to be on the plant? Is there a life cycle stage that's most susceptible to the product, or are different life cycle stages more susceptible to different forms of control? Where's the pest likely to be, and when will it be most active? So in this case, we're thinking about, if it's on the plant, is it going to be in the foliage, or is it going to be in the flowers, and how could you adapt your spraying to improve application to those specific areas? How can we influence the uptake? So are there any adjuvants we can use to increase feeding to improve uptake of an active ingredient? And finally, taking into account things like crop structure and how that can influence your application or choice of product. So if you've got a particularly dense canopy, is it going to be difficult to get that contact action that you need with some of the biopesticides? Is the flower type going to impact efficacy? So if you have a flower head that's pointing up where you can get your nematodes, venom pathogenic fungus directly into it and maintain within there, you might see some better efficacy than you would if you had a flower head that was pointing down where it's very difficult to get the active ingredient in. Okay, so now we've looked at some of the challenges, what are some of the solutions that we have? So I thought I'd focus on entomopathogenic fungi, as there's quite a few of these approved. They tend to be some of the most popular biopesticides, both in terms of number of active ingredients approved and products that we have in GB. So what is an entomopathogenic fungus? It's a microorganism that completes its life cycle through an insect host, often killing them in the process. As mentioned, there's quite a few of these available within the market. So things like Bavaria bassiana, so your neutralises and botanicards, Lancocilium, so Mycotyl, metarhizium-based products, so things like MET52, or now as Lalgard, and Isera or Paculomyces-containing products, which is a product called no-fly. What are some of the key considerations that need to be taken into account with these products? Well, they are living organisms, so they're highly dependent on environmental conditions. Factors like temperature and humidity influence them quite a lot. And think about how you can get contact onto the insect, and whether pest population sizes and life cycle speed are going to mean that actually it's probably not the most effective product for you to use at that time. So going into a bit more detail about entomopathogenic fungi, this diagram is looking specifically at Bavaria bassiana, but the concept will ring true across most of the entomopathogenic funguses. What you're doing is applying the spores in formulation in the product, trying to get that direct contact onto the insect. Those spores will then germinate and penetrate into the insect's body, and they'll do this through a series of penetration pegs and enzymes. The mycelium will then feed on the host's hemolymph, using that nutrition to grow and develop, ultimately leading to the death of the insect by dehydration. And that death will tend to take between anywhere between 2 to 3, it says there, but we've seen anything up to kind of 3 to 5 days for that to be efficacious. And that time is driven by environmental conditions as well, so things like temperature and humidity. So if we look at a specific product example and go into a bit more detail in terms of points for consideration, so Neutralisel contains Bavaria bassiana, so a fungal-based biopesticide. As referenced in the previous slide, it does take time to actually see the death of the insect, but what you should see post-infection is a colour change, which can be quite difficult to see, especially depending on which pest and species of the pest you're looking at. But behavioural changes and cessation in feeding will occur after infection. So if you have the correcting conditions, you can start to see the sporulation of white spores out of the insect after they've been infected. Ensuring you have a fine spray to get good coverage is very important. With Neutralis, you have an OD formulation, but with some of the other products, it might be necessary to use an adjuvant to improve spread to get better coverage. Thinking about what time of day is best to apply is important, and this kind of ties into the environmental conditions. So, for Neutralis to be effective, you really want to be between that 20 to 30 degrees area. It is effective down to lower temperatures, but as you start moving down the temperatures, it does become less effective. Thinking about humidity, so above 60% relative humidity for the product to be efficacious, but above 80% relative humidity to start getting that final stage of the life cycle where you start seeing those sporulation of white spores out of the insect, which can lead to an epizootic infection and infect further insects. In terms of thinking about whether morning or evening is most effective, I tend to lean towards evening. If you think about applying in the morning, it may be that you apply when conditions are conducive, but then the sun comes out, the humidity drops, the temperature rises quite significantly, and actually the temperature on the leaf can be quite a lot higher, which might lead to spores being damaged. The OD formulation in the Neutralis does also help with a bit of UV protection, but if it is a particularly hot day, then you are likely to damage some of the spores. And with any of the biopesticides, it's likely that repeat applications will be needed, because you're only going to get the insects that you get direct contact with or take up a lethal residual dose. And a top tip generally for biopesticides, those biopesticides that are in formulation, the active ingredient can be quite large. A lot larger than conventional active ingredients, so you might find that the product has separated out. So gently rotate the container to ensure that the spores are mixed evenly throughout the container so that you're getting the right amount of active ingredient going into the tank. And just to kind of push home the point about the importance of life cycle stage and ensuring you're getting contact with the insect, this is some research that was done on thrips being controlled by Bavaria bassiana, looking at different stages of the life cycle of thrips that the product was applied to, but then also looking at the exposure type, so residual where the insect's taking up a dose through walking over residues, and then residual plus topical where you have that residue exposure, but then also direct topical application onto the insect. And you can see that the level of insect mortality when you've got that topical application is significantly higher than just being picked up by the residues. So it's really, really important to try and get that direct contact onto the insect.
So over the course of the presentations, Alex and I have mentioned how timing is really critical with a lot of these products, and Jack referenced earlier the use of these growing degree hour or growing degree systems to help improve forecasting and ultimately timing of control. So I just thought I'd quickly go through how these GDH models can be used to help improve monitoring, which could help you either improve the timing of your application of macrobiological controls or the improved crop walking leading to better spot treatments with biopesticides. So this is a project that we worked on with some Sainsbury's growers within their Berry IPM group. We collected their data from previous seasons and mapped the environmental conditions against the crop walk data for when growers were seeing thrips come in. So we saw that the first infection of thrips in the crops was at a GDH count of 3,150, taking off the base development temperature for thrips development. So we thought if we could establish populations of macrobiological controls in this case before we started seeing the issue, then we could have a level of control that would be greater than previous seasons where growers were kind of just applying based off of what they thought best practice would be. So going forward with the project, we designed a GDH widget in the Zenzi dashboard where we're counting up towards that GDH threshold that we'd established from previous seasons data. You can see that the widget's got a now line on it. So this is having weather data fed into it as well to start predicting forward past the current date what the trend's going to be. And that's quite important, obviously, for seeing when you're going to cross over that threshold line, but also feeding in that weather data can give you an understanding of if the weather in the next few days or week is going to be significantly different. So, say we have a cold snap after a slightly warmer week in spring, it might look like we're trending towards that threshold, but then actually we're not going to reach the threshold for longer than we thought, so it might not be necessary to apply the control measures. So we start tracking that trend towards the GDH threshold as we start getting closer. So around about the 2800s mark, we were looking at establishing the macrobiological controls so that we'd have that population there when the thrips were coming into the crop. But also with biopesticides, you could look at increasing your level of crop walks, specifically looking for the target pest, so that you can find any hotspots early and treat them as hotspots to actually have a more targeted biopesticide application. And that's just the way that standard environmental data can be used and displayed in a way that can help you improve your crop protection program. So, as mentioned at the top of the presentation, I thought I'd do a relatively whistle-stop tour of some of the products that are available on the GB market, both the biopesticides and the conventional chemistry. So, the next couple of tables are taken from the HDB website. With a bit of updating done to them. So these are the biopesticides that are available with reference to thrips control. So azadirachtin or neem oil, that is available as a product called azatin. It's partially systemic on some host plants, but not all. Application should start prior to infection or flower opening. It's rain fast in 3 hours, but there are some restrictions around worker exposure on the approval notice, so do have a look at that. See, Bavaria bassianas, which we've touched on quite extensively, so I'm not going to spend too much time looking at that, but they do have those environmental conditions that you need to be aware of. Maltodextrin-based products, so there's a few out there, but I think the one going forward is going to be Eradicote Max, but Eradicote and Majestic both work in very similar ways and contain maltodextrin. Physical mode of action, so blocking spiracles of pests and ultimately dying via suffocation. So again, very important to think about how you're going to get that contact directly onto the pest. Fatty acid-based products, so Tech Bomb and Flipper. Again, contact is very important because these are desiccants. You need to get that good contact with the insect to actually desiccate it. It's quite important, or it's important with all biopesticides to make sure your tank is clean because residues within the tank can affect funguses or bacterial-based products. But with the fatty acid-based products, it has been known in the past for them to essentially act as a tank cleaner. So if you think your tank might be quite dirty, it's likely that these acid-based products are going to strip those residues out. Important to think about your quality of water. So do you need to use a conditioner? I think with Flipper, the recommended conditioner is a product called Exfusion. And then Lenticillium, which I've mentioned a couple of times in the presentation, is available as a product called Mycotel. And the concepts there are very similar to application of Naturalis. So another entomopathogenic fungus has certain temperature and humidity requirements that it needs for efficacy.
Okay, so moving on to the conventional chemical options. Obviously, with any plant protection product, it's important that you check the approval, either the on-label approval or EMU, to make sure that the crop you're going to be applying the product to has the correct authorization. So do speak with your agronomist. This is quite a general table to just give people a flavour, but for your specific crops, please do read the label and speak to your agronomist. So with the table, the products that are in bold are products that have thrips control mentioned either on their approval or on their EMU notice. The only two that don't are spirotetramat and acetamiprid. So the HDB suggests that there is some efficacy from these products, which shows through the trials work done in Sceptre Plus, but they're generally more used for pests like aphid and whitefly. In terms of the products that are in bold, you've got your abamectin, so Dynamect, which tends to be used for spider mite control and leaf miner control. That will have some effect on thrips as well. Probably your most common is your spinosad-containing products, so Conserve or potentially, depending on what crop you're in, Tracer. Those are effective. There has been some resistance noted in the past, but I think with improved IPM and proper management and rotation of these active ingredients, we're seeing it become more effective. Then we move on to the pyrethroid-based products. You can see within those IRAC groups, the top four have different groups, and then there's three all in the pyrethroid group. So do make sure you rotate these properly within your spray program and work that out with your agronomist. But things like deltamethrin, lambda-cyhalohafrin, and then general pyrethrin, so Desis Protec, Hallmark with Xeon technology, and Sprucis, all have an effect on thrips. And then the most recent product to the ornamentals market would be Mainspring, which is a cyantraniliprole-containing product. Depending on what crop you're in, that might either be Verimark or Menecto 1, falling in a different IREC group, so Ryodine Receptor Modulator. So again, another good one to look to work in terms of resistant management alongside your biopesticides and macrobiological controls. Working via contact and translaminar action. There are some worker restrictions on the approval, so do read those and address them. ICL have sent out some information on how these can be addressed. So do get in contact with your agronomist and ICL to find out how you can use this product effectively in your crops. So, as mentioned earlier in the presentation, looking at how we can improve uptake of active ingredients, very important, and thrips control. So things like appetants can be really effective. This product here is a product called a tracker, which is a liquid formulation of fructose and glucose, so sugars, and that will just increase the feeding of the thrips, making it more likely that they're going to take up an active, a lethal dose of the active ingredient, sorry, and give you a good level of control. So any sprays where you're looking to improve uptake from feeding, so sprays against caterpillars, spider mite, thrips, and adult vine weevil, a tracker will have good effects. So having just covered off those conventional chemicals and the biopesticides, they're all registered plant protection products. So obviously plant protection products can only be used by professional growers. So there needs to be the correct sprayer qualifications on site to ensure that these are being used safely. You'd see within the chemical products there, I'd listed the IRAC codes. So it's very important that you're rotating that chemistry. There are resistant populations present of thrips within the UK, and they do breed very quickly. So resistance can be bred up very quickly. So make sure you're rotating those active ingredients effectively. Check what effects the application may have on your macrobiological control populations. That's obviously going to be very key. Some of them are far more persistent than others, so if you're looking at re-establishing those macrobiologicals, do have a look at that. And obviously consult with your agronomist to ensure all of the points above, but also whether the products have the correct approval for your crops. The approvals for products change very rapidly. So do always get in contact with either your agronomist or supplier to make sure that the approval is still in place. And as with any plant protection product, always read the label and product information before use. And for further detail on warning symbols and phrases, these will be included on the safety data sheet, which you should also have a copy of. And so lastly, I'm aware that we've got a few people that have signed up to the webinar today that will be working in environments where plant protection products might not be possible to be used. So there are a couple of physically acting products which fall outside of the scope of the regulations that could potentially be used. So Protac, this is a silicon-based product that forms a silicon net structure over the body of the insect, and ultimately leads to the insect then dying through suffocation. Control of mites, aphid, thrips, whitefly, and scale. always spray on a dry crop. Obviously, if you're looking to get that coating dry over the top of the insect, the product needs to be able to dry. So relative humidities need to be lower. So this might fit quite nicely into a program as well, where some of the entomopathogenic funguses won't be affected. If rain's expected, obviously you're then going to wash that coating off. So don't apply if rain is expected. Again, similarly to a lot of the products we've mentioned today, getting this kind of product in early is going to be key to seeing it being effective. Another physically acting product is SB Plant Invigorator. We have had some good results against thrips, and there's been some reports and feedback from growers that it's working effectively. It's not something we directly advise, but it's got good efficacy against whitefly aphids, spider mite, mealybug, different scale species, and a range of other soft-bodied pests. But yeah, it's difficult with thrips that are quite cryptic to get good coverage with SBPI. And so that completes my presentation. So thank you for your time. If you have any questions, please do leave them in the chat, or feel free to drop me an email. But yeah, thanks for your time.